Hello, the title of this video is How to Estimate Voltage Spikes from Layout Parasitic Inductance in Switch Mode Power Supplies. My name is Colin Warwick, I'm the Product Manager for Power Electronics at Keysight ESOF EDA. The trend in Switch Mode Power Supplies is to use wide bandgap devices because these enable a higher switching frequency and higher edge speeds, the DIDT of the switch loop. These two in turn enable a smaller, lighter, cheaper a power supply because the magnetics and the capacitors can be smaller if you switch them more frequently. And the high edge speeds enable high efficiency. There's less heat dissipated when you have lower switching losses when the transistors make the transition more quickly. But these high slew rates come with a dark side. In particular, the large spike voltage and noise generated across layout parasitics, particularly the inductance of PCB traces. This phenomenon is often called conductor electromagnetic interference or conducted EMI. For example, in this circuit I sweep the edge speed to increase DIDT and monitor the spike voltage from the anode of the diode to ground. It has a non-optimum trace length of around 50 millimeters in this case. The result is, of course, as I make the edge faster, the spike voltage gets bigger and bigger and bigger. We showed you how to deal with this in our previous video entitled How to Design DC to DC Power Converters, but a frequently asked question was, when should I start to worry about layout parasitic inductance? Is there a quick rule of thumb that says, kind of, caution, further investigation is needed? The answer is yes, and this follow-up video is about how to make these estimates. It was inspired in part by Professor Robert Erickson's lecture notes entitled EMI and Layout Fundamentals for Switch Mode Circuits. I include a link to that presentation in the notes that go with the download that accompany this video. So let me show you the rule of thumb, and I'll show you how I derived it, and so you can know the breadth of its applicability and some exceptions. The quantity to calculate is this. You take mu naught, which is the permeability of free space, multiply the length of the loop, the switch loop, and divide by the load resistance. This gives you a quantity in the units of time. So the thing you have to consider is, if the rise time of your circuit approaches this quantity, then you have to worry about layout parasitic inductance and do further analysis. Now, in SI units, the permeability of free space, mu naught, is actually defined to be 4 pi times 10 to the minus 7 henries per meter exactly. But the problem is 1 meter and 1 henry scale is not really intuitive. A more intuitive way of looking at this mu naught number is in nanohenries, which is more the kind of value you get in a circuit, and millimeters, which is typically the kind of size of a circuit. So it turns out that this number is 1.26 nanohenries per millimeter. But for our purposes, we're going to approximate quite heavily in this video, so I'm just going to round it down to 1 nanohenry per millimeter to make it very easy to remember and more intuitive. So given this approach to units, we can plug in some numbers and see where we should become concerned. So the vacuum permittivity, we said, is 1 nanohenry per millimeter roughly. Loop length in millimeters to be consistent with units, so let's say, take an example, a rather large loop, 50 millimeters. The load resistance in ohm, let's say you've got a 5-volt USB charger delivering 2 amps into a smartphone, so the phone presents a 2.5 ohm load to the switch mode power supply. So given this rule of thumb, we need to become concerned if the edge speed in nanoseconds approaches 1 times 50 divided by 2.5, which is 20 nanoseconds. We have to use these units consistently. But if our switch mode power supply edge approaches this value, then we need to be concerned about voltage spikes. So we start our derivation with the inductor equation, V spike equals L parasitic times DIDT. The current goes from 0 to I on in the edge rise time, tau. So DIDT is simply I on divided by tau. So the next step is to define a quantity R effective with units of ohms. This isn't a real physical resistor, but it has units of resistance, so I gave it a letter R. But it's just the ratio of the voltage across the switch when it's off to the current through the switch when it's on. And a quick way to estimate RF if you don't know V off or I on is, in general for switch mode power converters, RF, the effective resistance, is something on the order of R load, and the coefficient between R load and R effective is a function of the duty cycle. Some simple algebraic function of the duty cycle. For example, for a simple buck, the function is just 1 over D, the duty cycle. So for example, when D is a half for the buck circuit, R effective is simply twice the load resistance. So if you know the load resistance, just double that to get R effective. But usually you do know V off and I on, so this is a more accurate way of doing it, assuming you have those two numbers available. So the next step is to take our inductor equation and substitute for I on and rearrange. And we get this formula: V spike over V off is L parasitic divided by tau and the R effective. The next step is to observe that V spike must be a lot less than V off. The ratio should be like 1% if its ripple is the limit, maybe 10% if device overstress is the limit. But in any case, V spike must be a lot less than V off. And because V spike over V off is equal to L parasitic over tau R effective, that implies that this quantity also must be less than 1 because these two quantities are equal. So if we rearrange this right-hand part here, we end up that the tau must be much greater than L parasitic over R effective for freedom from large spikes. So the next question is, how big is L parasitic? Now let's say you don't have a field solver handy, you want to know what the inductance is, and you use the algebraic formula from our book. You'll see this seems to be quite complicated, but at their core, they're actually quite simple. They're all of these things summarized down into three parts. One is the permeability of space. The second is some kind of length, the geometric length of the loop. And the third is what we call a form factor, which is usually the logarithm of the ratio of two geometric factors. And because the geometric factors are almost always on the same order of magnitude, this logarithmic form factor is on the order of 1. So we'll approximate that as 1, and then we'll just reduce to the permeability of free space and the length of the loop. I'm assuming, of course, here that the loop is one turn. If you have more than one turn, obviously you've got an n squared factor. But here, in our case, the loop is one turn, and so it reduces down to this form factor on the order of unity, the permeability of free space, and a loop length. There may be a factor of 2 pi or whatever, but as an approximation, we just take a loop length and multiply it by the permeability of free space. So our final rule of thumb is that the rise time must be greater than the permeability of free space, which is about 1 nanohenry per millimeter, time the loop length in millimeters divided by the R effective, which is V off over I on, for freedom from large spikes. If you don't have R effective, as I mentioned at the beginning, you can use R load instead. It's about the same thing. In that case, the rise time must be much greater than permeability of free space, the loop length divided by R load. So how does this rule of thumb work out in practice? I've coded up this equation in ADS here, and let's compare it to our accurate result from the circuit solver. You can see the spike here is around just under 3 volts, and the formula is about under 3 volts. So let's sharpen up the edge and see how the spike grows, as we did before, but now we're recalculating our rule of thumb. And it has the right general trend. It's not super accurate, but that's not surprising, given the number of approximations we've got in here. But you can see when the edge gets sharper, we've gone from just under 3 volts to about 6 volts here. So it works pretty well, but obviously it's not as accurate as a field solver. Now this parasitic inductance for a planar loop can be quite large. Obviously this can be on order of millimeters. This is nanohenries per millimeter. So this can be quite a large number. It can be several nanohenries. And if this is on the order of a unit ohm, then the rise time limit is going to be tens of nanoseconds. What we'd really like to do is to get this inductance down. Is there any way of getting this inductance down? And indeed, if you break away from planar loops, there is. What about non-planar loops? If you take the loop to be on a multi-level non-planar loop, where one trace is the outbound current and there's some kind of ground plane to return the current, we can break this model of the form factor and we end up with a new form factor which depends now on the thickness of the insulator. And this is important because we can make this thickness of the insulator quite small. We can make this below a millimeter. Typically a printed circuit board, the insulator is 0.1 of a millimeter or so. So this gives us a way of making this loop inductance a lot smaller. We still have to count up the number of squares on the loop, in other words, the loop length divided by the width of the trace. But we can make this width quite broad, and we can make the insulator quite thin. So this gives you a much lower inductance per unit length. It can be 0.1 of a nanohenry per millimeter or less for a given length of loop. So this method is widely used. You put in a ground plane effectively and you can reduce the inductance quite considerably. In the download we have three layout examples, two planar loops, one's larger than the other. And the third example is this idea of using a ground plane to reduce the loop inductance considerably. So now we've got our rule of thumb for a couple of cases, those planar loops and the non-planar loops. Now we've got that number, why bother to use an EM field solver? Well, of course, the rule of thumb is just an approximation. There's probably factors of 2 pi in there and so on. It's not accurate enough to base a real design off of. You want to use an EM field solver to get accuracy. With an EM field solver, you get numerical solutions of Maxwell's equations. You take into account the exact geometry and all the fringing effects that we neglected, all those factors of 2 pi and log a over b and so on. The other thing to remember is that PCB traces are not pure inductors. They're not even purely lumped elements. They're actually distributed elements. And EM field solvers will give the EM-based model based on network parameters. Now, you don't have to be familiar with network parameters. It all happens under the hood. But the point is that the EM field solvers will have the ability to model distributed elements, not just simple LC type of elements. The other thing that field solvers can take into account is skin depth and surface roughness of conductors. They become increasingly important with the high frequency harmonics at those harmonics of your square wave. And the other thing they can take into account is frequency dependent dielectric constant, which has an impact especially on the capacitive part. As I mentioned, the traces are not purely inductors, they're more like RLCG type elements, but they're not even lumped elements, are distributed RLCG ladders, if you like. So once you've violated this rule of thumb and the rise time gets close to that rule of thumb, recommend you use a field solver and get an accurate answer and explore the design space. You can play around with the loop geometries, compare planar versus non-planar loops, and do an accurate model of your design. So here's a summary in the next step, which is to get the example file. We gained an understanding of how to estimate when voltage spikes from layout parasitic inductance start to become a problem in a switch mode power supply. The rules of thumb we developed for a planar loop is shown here, and a two-layer loop is shown here. We learned that two-layer loops have a much lower inductance than a planar loop of about the same size. We learned that you have to use a field solver to create an accurate EM-based model if the rule of thumb is violated when you start to approach this quantity. You can download the example files that I showed today at this URL, or you can click on the link in the description area. And thank you for watching this video.